But Marie, tell us who you are.
Marie Bjerede. I run a little consulting company called Emergence, but I have spent most of my life leading technology teams in wireless communication.
Well, now you mentioned a few of those things at the retreat we were at. And as you know, I'm really interested in what I see as sort of the 21st century workplace. And it seems to me that you were implementing some of the 21st century stuff even back in the 20th century.
So yes.
what did you do that was different?
There were a number of things that I did that was different. I started off leading teams in the same way any junior leader does, which is you do all the work yourself. And pretty quick realized that you just hit a wall doing that. And then I learned about delegation and teamwork, but you hit a wall doing that too. There comes a point where in traditional modes of leadership, where you're the single point of failure, where you're the one who has to set all the direction, where you're the one who decides whatever it needs to be doing, but there's a limit to how much you can actually allow other people to accomplish. And so I spent about a dozen years in my career running a remote office with about 70 folks in it, and we did a lot of experimenting there with how teams should work. And one of the very first things we did, or that was important for me, was to stop trying to make all the decisions and have all the answers and sit back and listen and see how things evolved when we attacked problems more as a team rather than from a top-down perspective. And it turns out that, you know, my team together was collectively far smarter than I could ever be. And we got into the habit of the sort of reflective practice where we would try things, we would meet and we would have conversations about our daily work, but we'd also have meta conversations about how we thought about our work and what about it we thought was important and what we thought was working and not working. And as a result of those meta conversations, we were able to pretty early detect what we thought was serving us, what we thought wasn't serving us, and getting rid of the stuff we didn't like. And so we developed this culture where rather than having the notion of somebody at the top sets a goal and everybody else gets rewarded according to how well they execute that goal, we had a team, and together we tried to identify what was important for our organization, what were our metrics of success, and then we all gave each other recognition according to how we forwarded success. And so when it came time, so in some ways it's kind of mapped onto traditional ways of doing management. So you would look at performance evaluations. So that started off being a time when those of us who had been put in charge would judge the people who were not in charge, which nobody was ever comfortable with, but that's kind of the way corporations work. Then we kind of moved to a phase where we were able to say, you know what, this whole judging thing doesn't really do much for us. We want to move more to a coaching style. What are the things we can do at these points that will give people the information and help that they need to get better? But even that's kind of a patronizing approach. So we went from that to saying, what we really want to do is, as managers, rather than trying to evaluate what people are doing, is to kind of sit back and hear from the entire community of people who are working together, what are the things that they thought really brought value to the organization and who had the biggest impact in doing that, so that we moved to being able to recognize people in a very authentic way, not in a superficial checklist way, but in a way that they knew that we understood what their contributions were, and we got a deeper sense of and continually improving sense of what are the things that really make our organization better and better and better and better. So eventually the kinds of things that we started looking at were very different than the traditional stuff. We had some traditional things where it says, who was very productive? Who had great teamwork? Who had leverage? Leverage for us is, what are the things that you do that help other people be more successful? Who represented our organization well? And so that's one of those very ambiguous things where, what does represent our organization well mean? It's not something you can reduce very well to a checklist, but you certainly know it when you see it. When customers are happy, when customers rave about the kind of service they've gotten from people, when they are asking for people by name and saying, I want this person on my team, those are the times when you know that you've got that somebody's representing as well. So, so that's one element of it. But then there's also doing that within the organization. Mm. If you want to take time and work from home, if you want to have flexibility in your working arrangements, do you self-manage? Or does that suddenly put a burden on somebody else to help you be successful? Or are you representing yourself well to your community, to the people you're collaborating with? So I think that the biggest shift really was in what we valued, from obedience to independently moving the ball forward. And what we ended up seeing as a result of this continual reflection and refinement was what we considered to be self-organizing teams. And so you would have teams whose goals were, well, we had two key goals that it took us years to evolve, but they're pretty simple. One was to be the organization that everyone would want to work with, and the second was to be the place that everyone wanted to work at. And so when we looked at who made the biggest contributions, it was who made the biggest contributions to those particular things. And of course, folded up in that is how much stuff did you get done for somebody, how easy did you make it for somebody, how much logistics and management did you offload from somebody, and so on. So we really started valuing teams that would move the ball forward in each of those areas. And what was interesting is that you would think that when you flatten things that way that you would need to have a lot more communication going on and people talking all the time. But what we actually found was that because our culture became so clear and our goals became so, has so many examples of success, that teams would actually work independently, perhaps not communicate for days, weeks, or even a month at a time. And yet when they came back together, we were still very much on the same page. The various things that we had done to move the ball forward according to our two goals all dovetailed very neatly and gave us new opportunities and synergies.
Now, did everybody go along with this, or did some say, no, I want it sort of the old way, tell me what to do?
There were some people who really emotionally felt as though they wanted to have that A+. You are an A+ person,
right?
Not, well, this time your contributions were X due to what you were working on, who you were working with. Your contributions were still X. We're not judging you, we're judging what happened. But I think over time, those people actually started to kind of relax and feel more comfortable. And when they found themselves again in situations that were more like the old style, they didn't like it anymore. There were other people who, mostly people I think who wanted to be in charge, who wanted to have the opportunity to be in that position of setting direction and then evaluating everybody else according to how well they fulfilled their particular view of what needed to happen. Those folks I think never became comfortable, and they generally self-managed out of the organization. They left happy, they left on good terms, but they didn't feel it was the place for them.
Now, did other units within the company see this and say, we want some of that, or did it end up being sort of self-contained?
It was mostly self-contained, but partly because we were geographically so far away. Although there were certainly a number of organizations that adopted some of our measures and some of the things that we were doing, but they were really too far away to have that much cross-pollination.
Yeah. Any just general advice you give to people who are sort of forming up new leadership groups and are absent a structure to begin with?
Yeah.
How should they start?
Well, I think most people who are successful get to be successful through a certain toolkit, which often is, I know what I'm doing, I know where I'm going, follow me, let's go. And that's really important a lot to get you to a certain place. But when you start wanting to scale that, when you start wanting to be able to create that kind of energizing and inspirational environment on a large scale, you can't let all of that rest with one person. And that means that you have to move from a culture of purely short-term goals to one where you kind of let go of control and set goals at a higher level that people really can understand and consistently see as what's valued in that culture.
All right. Well, thank you very much for sharing this with us.
My pleasure. Thank you.